thank you. Thanks for coming, and let's get started. So, the challenge, inspire people to change for a more sustainable future. You know, often when we think about environmental problems like climate change and the solutions, we think of government policies, we think of new technologies. Those, of course, are important. But most fundamentally, we need, in order to make long-term change on environmental issues, we need to change people. We need to change their behavior. We need to change their decisions about what car they drive, how they drive the car, what they eat, what kind of home they buy, what the appliances they get, and what decisions they make when they go to the ballot box. Now, myself and many of my scientific colleagues have assumed that that's a pretty simple thing to do. We do our research, we gather the facts, we tell people the information, and they make rational choices. As it turns out, it's not that simple at all. And I and a lot of my colleagues have been trying to figure out why that is. What I'd like to do this afternoon is spend a few minutes with you to talk about my journey in trying to understand that and what has led me to ask the rhetorical question, are artists the ultimate environmentalists? So to start with, I have a poster that I took. This is a poster that I came across way back in 1970, and you can see it's seen better days. It's a picture showing an astronomer in his observatory, and he's looking at, with this telescope, he's looking at a mobile of the solar system, instead of training the telescope on the great cosmos out there. And when I first came across this poster, I thought it was a great little lesson for me to show to my students, to warn them about getting overly fascinated with their model, their conceptual model, and losing track of the actual real world. I now have completely changed my view of this poster. And I think it's an illustration of the fact that by looking at images and representations that we make as human beings, we get windows onto what the natural world really is about. So in the case of climate change, I and my colleagues have published many, many reports for the public and for policymakers on the problem, the seriousness of the problem, the urgency of the problem, hundreds, perhaps thousands of reports, without a whole lot of progress. In the United States today, some 50% or so Americans agree that climate change is happening. A smaller percentage think that human beings are at a positive, and a much, much smaller percentage believe the problem is serious and urgent. Clearly, we're doing something wrong. What are we doing wrong? So we've begun to focus on some of the things we're doing wrong, and we talk a little bit about them. One of the things we're doing wrong, I think, is the message. We quite often focus on the disaster, the really bad things that are going to occur. And a great example of that is a video I'm going to show in just a second. When I worked for Environmental Defense Fund, we worked on a series of ads, public service announcements with the Ad Council, that were to convince people that climate change is a really important problem and we need to go out and do something about it. And here is the ad.
Global warming. Some say irreversible consequences are 30 years away. 30 years? That won't affect me.
So I think you would agree that that really gets your attention. I think got a lot of folks' attention when they appear when they're watching, you know, whatever show they watch at 9 o'clock on TV. But it really didn't change people fundamentally. And we now know that negative messages like this get people's attention, get their emotions going, but they quickly dissipate and it doesn't really affect them at these levels. So negative messaging is not such a good idea. We need more positive messages. Another thing we've learned about is the wrong messenger. Dan Kahneman and others have done a lot of work on this. And the classic example of this is a basketball game. And I know that right now, we're not really in the mood to talk about basketball. This is a picture you might remember from a pivotal moment in the game with Syracuse, where I think it's Fair crashed into Rodney Hood. The referee blew the whistle, and we're all waiting for the call. And all the Syracuse folks watching on television said, "Foul!" And all of us from Duke said, "Charge!" As it turned out, the referee said charge when he won the game. But the fact is that it's very, very predictable that one group of people with a given cultural identification would see an event one way And another group of people with another cultural identification would see the same event a different way. And so we have a lot of loyalty to our culture, to our group, to our tribe. And that influences how we make decisions. And it's not all that surprising. E.O. Wilson, many of you might know, is one of the world's greatest biologists, has been in social biology. And one of his latest books, The Social Conquest of the Earth, he talks about the fact that we evolved as tribes. And our very existence, our survival, depended upon our willingness to have loyalty to our tribe and to cooperate with our tribe and even give up our life for our tribe. And so that the vestiges of that is probably with us today, and that's why we identify, depending on our culture, with one or the other. And there's a lot of discussion about the fact that when someone like me goes to visit and talk to a more conservative audience about climate change, I'm immediately dismissed because of who I am, because I'm not part of the culture. And so we thought a lot about that. I think there's a lot of validity to that, but I think it's not really the ultimate solution. And to illustrate that, I found this picture on the web. I got to testify in front of Congress some months ago about climate change. The gentleman on my left, is Bjorn Borg. And he's a fairly famous skeptic. He published a book in the 1990s called The Environmental Skeptic, which got a lot of people excited. And he's kind of a rock star in the skeptics world. And so we have we're waiting before the committee hearing, and I was there in my suit and my tie, trying to look as conservative as possible. And Bjorn showed up in polo shirt, jeans, and sandals. And they all just gathered around him like he was a hero. And then the hearing came about, and at this particular point when this photograph was taken, I'm testifying and being very reasonable and rational and trying to paint a positive picture about what we can do with regard to the climate. And there's Bjorn looking at me, and he's got this bemused look, and I think what he's saying is, you don't have a clue. Whatever you're saying is not going to get through. So there needs to be something else this is supposed to do. So the other thing is, perhaps we overestimate the power of information. Many of you are aware of these kinds of cartoons. There's a big snowstorm, it's really cold. All these cartoons come out, and they say, oh, it's poor climate change, global warming people, I don't know what they're talking about, obviously it's not global warming. And we, you know, laugh, and we say, how naive. It's a global process, it's a climate process, a slow way in one place during one period of time isn't that big a deal. But it's actually much more fundamental. There was a recent study about 4 or 5 months ago that came out where they looked at people's opinions about climate change from week to week to week to week. And they found it fluctuated. And what those fluctuations corresponded to was the weather. When it was warm out, people were concerned about climate change. And when it was cold out, those very same people decided it wasn't a problem. On some really deep level, beneath the rationality, people's experience is determining their opinions about issues that should be determined by information. Another example is something called the overview effect. Now, the overview effect, which was coined by Frank White, refers to the fact that when astronauts, many astronauts, when they go into outer space and look back at the Earth, they come back there profoundly changed. Their whole attitude about the world, about people, has been profoundly changed, and they're environmentalists. And if you ask them why that is, a lot of them will talk about the fact that they've seen the Earth from a new perspective. They'll talk about the fact that they never realized they live on a planet. They never realized they lived on a round sphere, a contained round sphere. Now, of course, they knew it intellectually. But until they actually saw it with their own eyes and internalized it, they never really understood that that was the case. And it completely changed their attitude about things like the environment, global change, and so forth. Experiencing something trumps information. So what's that about? So I started thinking about some other issues, and one of the things I thought about is the history of environmentalism. In the 19-teens and 1920s, it's sort of the modern environmental movement gathered steam in the United States. That's when Teddy Roosevelt shows up the Park Service, and there's a whole lot of work in terms of conservation. But at the same time, there were really, really important artists. The Hudson River Valley School painted these beautiful, beautiful canvases of the Hudson River landscape to warn people about what we were losing. Philosophers like Thoreau and Emerson and Leopold in New York talk about the beauty of the environment. And many, many people think that these artistic works and philosophical works had a major impact on interest in getting people excited and concerned about the environment that made it possible for the conservationists to make progress. In the 1960s and 70s, we saw the Clean Air Act, the Clean Water Act, the Birth of Earth Day, a whole lot of political upheaval and movement. One of the fundamental things that happened in the late 1960s, early 70s, was we saw this picture. For the first time, human beings saw a picture from space of planet Earth, much like the oblivious. And many people argue it was the experience of seeing this picture that catalyzed the Earth movement, the environmental movement in the United States in the 60s and 70s. Images, sound, artistic expression, what's that about? So then I thought back on a book that I read some years ago called Ishmael by Dan McKinney. It really was a cult book, and I highly recommend it to you. And it's the story about this narrator who was somewhat disillusioned because he grew up in the 60s, he was a hippie, he thought the world would change, and it didn't change. And he comes across this ad that says, you want to change the world, you want to save the world, come to such and such address, such and such room, and such address. And he goes there. And the room is a girl in the room, Ishmael. And through some sort of telepathy, the gorilla communicates with the narrator and tells him the story of evolution, the story of the Earth, from the point of view of gorillas and animals as opposed to the point of view of the human being. Initially, the narrator is sort of repulsed by the gorilla, his hugeness and his strangeness. But as he gets to know the gorilla and have a face-to-face confrontation with it, he begins to identify with the gorilla. He begins to feel one with the gorilla, with the Earth, and with the environment, and with the need to preserve habitat. And he is fundamentally changed by that interaction with the group. And that put me in mind of another philosopher that I read about in college, Manuel Levinas, who is a Talmudic scholar, existential philosopher. And he talks a lot about the other. So it's a theological term, meaning that which is not you, that which is not us or me. And the fact that quite often we are suspicious of the other, just like the other Muslim was talking about with the other tribe. But he argues that transcendence, the way to get transcendence out of ourselves, is to have a face-to-face confrontation and meeting with the other, with other people, as he's talking about. And it's by taking responsibility for and relating to and being with other people that we ultimately transcend ourselves and get to a higher level. Now, Levinas was not an environmental philosopher, but if I can have a little leeway here to find myself in my own road. You can think of this as having an environmental theme as well. The narrator has a face-to-face experience with Ishmael and is changed about the Earth. When we have experiences, fundamental experiences with the other, with the Earth as an other, and we take it on as part of ourselves, as part of our very being, we are fundamentally changed in a way that would change our behavior about issues like climate change. And so I wonder if, in fact, there's this wonderful thing that artists can do in all the different mediums. They can take sounds and images and stuff that we see, and they can frame it in a way that affects us at our very core and gives us an experience of that beauty in ways that we could not imagine. This is a picture taken by local artist Marjorie Pearson, who's been using pictures like this to alert people to the disappearing of the wetlands in Louisiana. Rather than showing the devastation, she's inspiring people by showing the beauty. I love this picture because you have this reflection of the water and the sky as if they're all one, and somehow we're perhaps as part of that all one. And so that has led me to ask the question, if we want to change the Earth and we need environmentalists, are artists the ultimate environmentalists? Thank you very much.